Mr. David Williams and Dr. Boyle will introduce our guest today.
Today we have the great pleasure to welcome the Hindu leader, Mahavirupa and Mahapramatma. Please. And I guess we have many Hindu students here, and I met them last time. So let's begin the activity by convening prayer. Please, Trên một dòng chí tôn cao ngự giữa Tây Phương nắm giữ thiên điều dưới ngọc hư kể bao nhiêu thiên liên các đấng lập triều trị dân một nuôi nâng tinh thần tinh khiết hai dạy rằng cho biết tội tình ba lo trị thế thái bình cộng chung pháp luật thiên đình trí công các con vốn trong dòng thánh thể phép tu di là kẻ tu hành mở đường tích cực quay linh cảnh phương thiết giáo dễ hành tinh chân đại từ phụ ra ơn diệu đàn diện trí phạm hờ giận ghét ganh để tâm dưới ánh chí linh soi tường chân lý chỉ rằng chánh nhân cờ chuyển thế khó khăn lắm nổi mượn thánh anh xây đôi cơ đời thuận nhân tâm mắt thuận trời cầu kinh vô tử độ người thiện duyên nguyện trên cho yên trí não nguyện Phật tiên giải bảo chân linh mang danh hội thánh đã đành nâng tay nhục thể xây hình chỉ tôn nam mô đại tiên ông đại bồ tát ma Now, I would like Pastor David to read the English.
There in your heavens resplendent, Lord of the endless sky, Almighty, past teachings transcendent, raining down on us who abide, dispatch all enlightened spirits, that they may come to us as our guides, nurturing our minds towards purity and discerning the virtuous life. May we know through inspired governance, peace and true justice abound. May spiritual self-discovery make our sacred origins found. Pray, teach us to reach the ultimate truth. Guide us there through your grace. Extinguish emotions cruel and uncouth toward the human race. Within your guiding ray we bask as it illuminates our arduous path. To redeem the world, no easy task. Yet you transform a living death. By instruction makes right our hearts. Each thought and wordless prayer. May we receive blessed teachings of those who reign with you there. I lift my arm to your service to aid my fellow beings. May thou bless in me bone and nerve. Give it to me your children's need.
So how is everyone doing?
Great.
Excellent. So we already did the the prayers to begin with. And so I'd like to welcome everyone to a meeting of the Office of the Alliance of Religions where we meet together with youth and different members of the community as well as religious leaders in order to examine the scriptures and to thoroughly understand more deeply about what it is that composes our religions, what does it consist of within the different religions of the world, and how we can learn more about those things to lead to us working and joining together to achieve peace. Because the majority of the people, the billions of people in our world, they're believers. And so if we take that, and we also take that understanding that almost every single person wants peace, then we can take that thing that we have in common, which is our faith, and if we use that to join together, then that can end war, that can end division, and that can bring us into a peaceful future. And so that's what every single person here is doing today, and as we've had these meetings, that's what they're for. And so the topic of today's discussion will be the origin of religious scriptures. And so, I don't have a fun game for us to be playing today, but there is something that I want to do. Why don't everyone look at the person next to you? Make eye contact with somebody. Make a buddy. Okay, now that you have your eye contact, hold it for about 5 minutes. No, I'm just kidding. Look at them, and now, while you're still looking at them, close your eyes. Now I want you to smile as big as you can, and hold that smile, showing your teeth, and now open your eyes. Isn't it much, aren't they way better looking now? Tell them, you're better looking now. You should never take that smile off. So when people have joy within their heart, it's a beautiful thing. And even if you weren't smiling at first, if you see someone else smiling, it becomes infectious. And so that's what I hope that we can be here too, infectious. As people that are learning more and that are growing together and having peace, I hope that we can be infectious and that we can be contagious almost to the people out there in the world too, so that this can grow. And so one more thing that I want to do, as we're talking about the origin of religious scriptures, I want you, with your partner, take time to ask each other a question. And so why don't you ask them an answer for each other. What is it that you feel the most important thing that religion gives on a personal level? What's the most important thing to you that you find in religion? So let's think about that for maybe 1 minute, and then we'll continue. It's a very weighted question. Okay, well now that we've taken time to casually answer the most important question you could ever ask, we're going to go ahead and move on with our program. And so today we have an additional speaker than what we normally have, and her name is Mahavirupa, and so let's give her a warm round of applause just to welcome her here. And so I'm going to share a little bit about her at this time before she comes up and shares with us regarding the topic of the origin of religious scriptures. So Mahavirupa is a disciple of His Holiness Paramahamsa Nithyananda, and she is currently officiating as the Vice Chancellor for the Nithyananda University, which provides experiential life solutions to humanity in the form of programs, empowering them to live life to their maximum potential. So teachings from the age-old Vedic scriptures, simplified and delivered with relevance to society today, are being formulated as online courses to also be available shortly. So that's good to know. We'll follow up with you to look at those online courses as well. And so she shares her teachings of her guru, Nithyananda, with one and all, I'm sure, on a daily basis. And I know that she's dedicated her life to understanding religion in order to give other people a better understanding and a pathway as well. So let's invite her up at this time to speak on the topic of the origin of religious scriptures, and let's welcome her with a warm round of applause.
Thank you everyone for having me here. I'm Mahavirupa, and I'm honored to be here. I'm looking forward eagerly to sharing what I have to about the origins of the Hindu scriptures with you today. So the Hindu Dharma or Hinduism is often referred to by its practitioners as Sanatan Dharma. Vedic Dharma or Vedic traditional is the spiritual, philosophical, scientific and cultural system that originated in Bharat Varsh, the Indian subcontinent, that is based on the Vedas, and it is the oldest of all living religious traditions still practiced today. A Hindu, as per definition, is an adherent of the spiritual practices, yoga, philosophies, and scriptures of Hindu Dharma. The Hindu tradition is solely responsible for the creation of such original concepts and practices as yoga, Ayurveda, Vastu, Jyotish, Yajna, Puja, Tantra, Vedanta, Karma, Chakras, Brahman, Atman, etc. I know some of these names will be all foreign to you. They are Sanskrit. But basically, it is Vastu is the study of space, and Jyotish is astrology. Yajna is the fire rituals that are performed. Pujas are rituals, a temple offering, prayers. Tantra and Vedanta is the philosophical understanding of the scriptures. And so on. Brahman is consciousness itself. The Hindu Dharma or Sanatana Dharma has its origins in such remote past that it cannot be traced to any one individual. It is the only religion that is not founded in a single historic event or prophet, but which itself precedes recorded history. Some scholars view that Hinduism must have existed even in circa 10,000 BC, and that is the earliest of the Hindu scriptures, the Rig Veda, some of you may have heard of it, was composed well before 6,500 BC. Yet, in spite of the fact that it first evolved more than 5,000 years ago, Hinduism is also very much a living tradition. Hinduism is a modern term, but it represents the ancient, most living thought and culture of the world. The concept of Hinduism being a single monolithic religion is recent, dating back only to the 19th century. Many scholars liken Hinduism to a family of religions, with all affiliated members bearing a family resemblance. The Hindu tradition consists of several schools of thought. Thus, any definition of Hinduism is somewhat arbitrary and requires qualification. One such definition is the followers of Vedic Dharma, or those who follow the religious teachings outlined in the Vedas and their corollaries. This difficulty arises from its universal worldview, as it has concerned itself largely with the human situation rather than the Hindu situation. Instead of basing its identity on separating Hindu from non-Hindu or believer from non-believer, Hinduism has sought to recognize principles and practices that would lead any individual to become a better human being and understand and live in harmony with Dharma. Thus, Hinduism is rightly called a Dharma that has evolved by the great rishis, sages, and seers of ancient India. It emphasizes the Dharma, the right way of living, rather than a set of doctrines, and thus embraces diverse thoughts and practices. Hinduism has been called the cradle of spirituality and the mother of all religions, partly because it has influenced virtually every major religion. Hinduism is much more than an esoteric practice. For the millions of people who practice this religion, it is a way of life that encompasses all aspects of life, including family, social life, sciences, politics, business, art, and health behaviors. The sacred scriptures contain instructions on these aspects of life and have a strong influence on art and drama. While the ascetic practices of yoga are a well-known aspect of Hinduism, family life is also considered a sacred duty. Sanatan Dharma means eternal and universal law or principle that governs everyone, irrespective of culture, race, religion, belief, and practices. The two words, Sanatan Dharma, come from the ancient Sanskrit language. Sanatan is a Sanskrit word that denotes that which is beginningless, ananta, ananta, endless, and does not cease to be, that which is eternal and everlasting. With its rich connotations, dharma is not translatable to any other language. Dharma is from dhri, meaning to hold together, to sustain its importance. Its approximate meaning is natural law, or those principles of reality which are inherent in the very nature and design of the universe. Thus the term Sanatan Dharma can be roughly translated to mean the natural, ancient, and eternal way. These truths regarding the universal principle were divinely revealed to ancient rishis, sages. For many eons they were passed down orally and only later written down. Apparently around the start of Kali Yuga, when people's memories began to deteriorate. The distinction of dharma from the Western sense of religion is crucial to understanding Hindu religious identity. To the extent that Hinduism carries with it the Western meaning of being a religion, the words distort Indian reality. In the West, a religion is understood to be conclusive, that is, it is the one and only true religion. Second, a religion is generally exclusionary, that is, those who do not allow it, follow it, are excluded from salvation. Finally, a religion is separated, that is, to belong to it, one must not belong to another. Dharma, however, does not necessarily imply any of these. By its nature, Sanatan Dharma is God-centered rather than prophet-centered, experience-based rather than belief-based, beyond any historical date of founding. The process of growth, which comes from the seed, inherent in and inclusive of all. In the world, while about the world, both eminent and transcendent, the whole and the parts, loving of all and excluding of none. Sanatan Dharma is to human life what natural laws are to the physical phenomena. Just as the phenomena of gravitation existed before it was discovered, the spiritual laws of life are eternal laws which existed before they were discovered by the ancient rishis for the present age during the Vedic period. Sanatan Dharma declares that something cannot come out of nothing, and therefore the universe itself is a manifestation of the divine being. The Hindu tradition encourages Hindus to seek spiritual and moral truth wherever it might be found. While acknowledging that no creed can contain such truth in its fullness, and that each individual must realize this truth through his or her own systematic effort. Our experience, our reason, and our dialogues with others, especially with enlightened individuals, provide various means of testing our understanding of spiritual and moral truth. And Hindu scripture, based on the insights of Hindu sages and seers, serves primarily as a guide book. But ultimately, truth comes to us through direct consciousness of the divine or the ultimate reality. Hindus refer to it by many names, but the most common name is Brahman, which is relatively different in meaning and understanding from the conventional word God. The best approach to understand Hinduism is through its teachings. Hinduism rests on the spiritual bedrock of the Vedas, hence Ved Dharma, and their mystic issue, the Upanishads, as well as the teachings of many great Hindu rishis and gurus, sages and seers through the ages. One feature unique to Hinduism is its assertion that moksha, liberation or deliverance, can be achieved in this life itself. One does not have to wait for a heaven or death after death. It guides people along paths that will ultimately lead to the Atman, the innermost self, and becoming one with the Brahman, the universal consciousness. His Holiness Paramahamsa Nityananda, an enlightened master and my guru, he has been a guru. He is showing this path and is available to create this, provide this experience and awakening, and is doing to all seekers of truth today in the present day. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let's give her one more round of applause for the beautiful show. That was pretty great to have such a different perspective than what we've been hearing lately here. And it was very wonderful to be educated more on the origin of the Hindu religion as well, with how old it is, yet how even relevant it is in today's world and the people that practice and carry it out. And things that really, I think that we, anyone as a person of religion should really hold on to when hearing those words, is when it talks about being something that leads to being a better human being. That's what we all need to strive for, regardless of the faith that we have. And also something that was said that was very wise, it was all very wise, of course. It was talking about how that Hindu religion is something that encompasses all aspects of life, not just some. And I really feel that believers of all kinds, it can be easy for us to think of that, that's my religion and this is my life. But the thing is, when it comes about religion, when it comes about the path that we follow to becoming a better person, we have to understand that it is something that should encompass all aspects of our life. It is something that we should think of, this is who I am, this is life, rather than thinking that it's just something that I do. And also considering it something that is like a duty. Just like how she said that having a family, if I'm quoting correctly, having the correct type of family life is something that's considered a duty. And so us people as faith, you know, not to say particularly one way or another how someone's personal family should be, at least from my perspective. However, carrying out the aspects of our faith, that is a duty that we have to do and to complete. Especially because the duty that we're taking on as individuals here is being able to learn about this, being able to understand the different faiths so that we can take this to the people of the world and so we can make a better world. Not only just as us individuals, but just like we did with the smiling, if all of us individually change, then the people around us will change too. And so I was very touched by the words that you shared, and I just want to thank you one more time for everything that you shared. And so this next speaker is nearly as handsome as me. And of course you know by me saying that it's not Dr. Bowie, because then I would say he's much more handsome than me. But I'm talking about Pastor David. Pastor David, as you guys already know him, but to introduce him, he's someone that has traveled quite a bit sharing his faith and teaching others as well, and has really dedicated his life to understanding faith so that it can be given and shared with others as well. And he's going to share with us from the Christian perspective regarding the topic of the origin of religious scriptures. So let's please welcome him with a warm round of applause.
Good afternoon, everyone. I feel like I don't have a good concept of time anymore. I feel like all the hours of the day kind of mesh together for me. But good afternoon, everyone. I'm glad to be in front of all of you again, and also with these respected leaders. There's two places where I always feel like a celebrity. The first place is in this very room, because every time I come here, everyone makes me feel so warm and fuzzy inside. And the second place is with my mother. So both locations I am very grateful for and thankful for. And again, I want to thank you for all the words that you have shared with us today. And to share again, just like Dave was saying, from the Christian perspective, I will share a few verses from the Christian doctrine and the Holy Bible to describe the origin of where our scriptures derive from. For us, we have the understanding, and it's been stated many times in this office as well too, that in John chapter 1, it talks about how God in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And when we understand this concept, we can understand it according to even the natural order of what we see around the world as well too. All of us here, we were able to grow, we were able to be reared, and we're able to mature ultimately through the teachings that have passed down unto us, especially from that came from our parents. As we have grown up over time, the actions that we carry out, the instructions that become second nature or is natural within us, ultimately we can't just think of it as something belonging to ourselves, but ultimately these are the very teachings that come and pop up into our mind because of what our parents have taught unto us. And because in that way, you can say that we are still one with our parents, even though they are not around us physically speaking. In a way, they are one with us because of what? Because of the teaching that we have received and that we ingrained within our hearts and within our minds. Utilizing this natural order, God also, who is a creator of all things, wants to be connected to his children and to his creation. The way that he does this is also by making himself tangible through the very word that he has given. That's why, as we take a look, in 2 Timothy chapter 3, it is stated that all scripture is God-breathed or breathed out by God, and it is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. Then as you can see here, God, he makes his very word known. He breathes it out. He inspires it. But the way that he does this is that he chooses individuals to do this through.
For the Lord God does nothing without revealing his secrets to his servants, the prophets. And furthermore, in 2 Peter, it states, knowing this, first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture can come from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. Then, the first understanding of where the origin of God's word has come from is ultimately from God himself. But how it manifested here on earth is now what we want to decipher. How it manifested and how it became known on earth was first done 3,500 years ago through the prophet Moses. Moses, he carried out the very work of God through, just like what we saw earlier, through the inspiration of God and being moved by the Holy Spirit. That's why even the first five books of the Bible is recorded by Moses. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And we can see this content in those books as well too, where God speaks directly to Moses and he says to him, record these words down and recite it to the people of Israel. So ultimately, even the Christian scriptures didn't begin as Christian scriptures. The Christian doctrine, it began first with the Jewish text, starting from the Pentateuch, which is the first five books of Moses, leading on to other books of history, and also the prophets and the books of wisdom as well too. So all of this compiled together was never again belonging to Christianity at first. This was all Jewish doctrine. It was all Jewish text. However, what makes it now also belong to the Christian doctrine is not just the historical facts that are seen inside of it, but it was the prophecies and the promises that were recorded down. Recorded down now, again, from the inspiration of the Spirit of God to these different prophets. Now, many people, they'll ask, how do we know that these prophecies and these things really did come from God or not? That's why we turn to now what it says in Deuteronomy, through the words that God has spoke through Moses. But the prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name that I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of other gods, that same prophet shall die. And if you say in your heart, how may we know that the word that the Lord has not spoken? When a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the word does not come to pass or come true, that is a word that the Lord has not spoken. The prophet has spoken it presumptuously. You need not to be afraid of him. Then ultimately, the realm of truth, it stands on what? Especially for the foundation now of Christianity, the realm of truth is not just a person. The realm of truth is when the prophecy and the promise of the one who spoke it becomes true and it is fulfilled. And that's why, from the Christian scriptures, they were able to now see all of these prophecies, all of these promises inside the 39 books of the Old Testament, fulfilled one by one. Each of these individuals now, at the time of the first coming when Jesus appeared, they were witnesses to these things, and they recorded them down, not so much as a gospel, but they recorded them down, again, as a witness and as a testimony. But we ourselves today, we have it as the Gospels. That's why I'm breaking it down. The Old Testament, again, has the Mosaic Law, books of history such as Ruth, Ezra, so on and so forth. It also has different anthologies of wisdom and psalms, such as Proverbs and Psalms, and also prophetic recordings as well, too. As Jesus appeared at the time of the first coming, he said that this 39 books of the Old Testament, all of these were recorded to prophesy about his coming. And he explained each and every single one, showing how each of the prophecies was regarding him. And that's where we have the New Testament today, where it has 27 books describing now the words that Christ had given, the work of the apostles spreading now these very words, the epistles, which includes instructions to the churches that were developed at that time, and it also has a prophetic recording within the book of Revelation as well. Now, it's very easy to also continue to ask, well, the Bible, from its origin in the language of Aramaic, going to Hebrew, and then Greek, and then Latin, and then ultimately to where we are now in English, people will presume, well, the Bible has gone through so many different translations and so-called interpretations as well. How can we hold to its validity? Well, as we answer that question very briefly, because again, we can stand here all day to discuss this, but just in a brief way, how do we know that still, even through all of the translations from one language to where we are today, it all holds the same? Well, the thing is, right now, as we know, translation can be very difficult. Because I am also Vietnamese, I'll use an example from Vietnamese culture. If I say to Dave, "You are very ye tun," what does ye tun mean?
Cute.
Cute, right? But the literal translation of ye tun is easily loved, in a way, correct? Easily loved. However, when we translate it, it comes off as the word cute. It has that meaning inside of it. So we will think, well then, if there's even difficulty within a language like Vietnamese, then Aramaic, to Hebrew, to Greek, to Latin, all the way to English and where it is today, how do we know? To again, briefly just go over this concept, again, to show the validity of the origin of God's word, it's like this. God, what He preserved was not so much the translation. What He preserved inside of the Christian doctrine was the meaning inside of it. So the time of Moses, the meaning of God, the purpose of God that He wanted to convey, Moses, he conveyed it using now the words and also the culture at that time. 500, 600, 700 years later, God spoke to another prophet. Again, His very purpose and His will. However, during that time, the way that they conveyed it, do you think after 500 years, do you think technology and culture has advanced a little bit? A little bit. Even 100 years ago today, 100 years ago today, has technology and culture advanced, or is it the same? It's advanced, right? Then the way that we would describe television, and the way that 100 years ago, I don't even know if they had television, but hypothetically, if they were to describe a television set 100 years ago, the vernacular, the diction, the way that they would describe it, it would be much different than how we would describe it today. However, the meaning is still the same. That's why in the same way, when God, through His very Spirit, inspired each of the prophets in different eras, over a span of hundreds and thousands of years apart with one another, although within their own respective cultures, within their own respective eras and times, they recorded what they saw and heard in a very different way. However, what did God preserve through all of that? It was the meaning inside of it. And that's why one has to find what is the meaning that God is trying to convey inside of His word. And that's why from beginning to end of Genesis to Revelation, to be quite honest, even Christians, many Christians today, don't know that either. They can't see it themselves. All that they know is what they hold in their hands, and to be quite honest, it's done in a very naive way, where they just hold it and say, "I have faith in this." However, we have to understand what is the deeper meaning inside that has held true from the very beginning in Aramaic to where it is in English or in Vietnamese or in Spanish to where it is today. To give you a very brief synopsis of what that meaning is that has held since the very beginning to now, what God has been trying to convey inside the Holy Scripture of the Bible is the work of betrayal, destruction, and salvation. This very work of betrayal, destruction, salvation, He has shown in all of the different eras and cultures, regardless of what it was, He was able to still preserve that very meaning. And we have to see how that is now applicable to our life in this era today. But looking again just at the origin of the Christian doctrine, just to briefly summarize everything today, again, it was recorded 3,500 years ago, not beginning with Christianity, but beginning with Judaism, starting with Moses, the Law of Moses, the Prophets, and the Psalms. All of this anthology, this was now for the Jewish people. However, within their promises came now a reality and a fulfillment, which was seen in Jesus Christ.
through Jesus Christ, he was able to now give teachings and also give the reality of those very words. And that's what is recorded now in the New Testament, along with other promises that Christ has also displayed as well. So that is the origin in a very brief way for the Christian doctrine. And I thank you for listening in this time.
Thank you very much. Let's give him another round of applause. A little bit of extra for calling you cute. I did not plan that at all. Very interesting to look at the Christian scriptures of the Bible and to understand more in depth about why it came from the teachings of Judaism leading into the scriptures that now people have. And also even to understanding a little bit more about patterns that are seen throughout different eras. So thank you very much for sharing, and I'm sure that we're all curious to continue to learn more about even those things as well. And so now, without any further ado, we're going to bring the most handsome up. This was just a coincidence that he's the most handsome. But Dr. Bui, someone who not only has dedicated his life in the medical field to help people live in the flesh, but really has dedicated also his life spiritually helping people so that they can live in that way as well. And having a place like the Cowdai Center, and even whether it be like a physical clinic that they have in order to give people help, or this spiritual place that so many of us are here coming, a great, great work has come from this man's heart and from this man's actions as well. And so I'm sure that we're all excited to hear more about the origin of the Cowdai scriptures as well. So let's please welcome him up with a warm round of applause.
Thank you, Lily, for your kind word. Good afternoon, brother and sister.
Good afternoon.
We are brother and sister of the same family, the same Father God. And all of us have God inside ourselves. And we can cultivate ourselves to become united with the Supreme Being, with God. And we'll be guided by God. I'm very happy to learn the origin of the oldest religion of the world and then of Christianity. And we learn that the scripture always coming from God, the word of God. And Hinduism, the Veda scripture, were the channel, poetic hymn from the superior spirit from God. And with the divine consciousness, the oldest sage of Hinduism received the scripture of Hinduism. And the same thing for other religions. Hinduism was founded teaching that Supreme Being is the initial light, is the creator of the universe and all beings, and humans are the part of the initial light, and we return to be united with the Supreme Being, with God. In 2300 BC, Abraham received direct message from God. The Lord said to Abraham, "Leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and will bless you." And in Hebrew scripture, Jeremiah felt God touch his mouth, and it is I, Yahweh, who speak, and the word is coming from the mouth of God. Okay. We come back to Veda again. And they were channel poetic hymns from the God. And in the 14th and 13th century BC, Moses received instruction directly from God on Horeb to guide the Israelites out of Egypt. And then Jesus went up to the mountain to commune with Moses and Elias. in 14, and later on in the 7th century after death, Muhammad received the order from God to found a Muslim for the Arab. And Saint Gabriel came down to him and ordered him to read. And from that, Muhammad received the word from God and writing what we have right now is Quran. And for the youngest religions of the world, Kaudai, we have the same origin of scripture. And the scripture was coming from God by means of the Spiritism. Spiritism is a way of communication between human being and the supreme being and the superior spirit. What you see is called Nokke, which is a device to communicate and receive the writing from God. And the first disciple of God is Mr. Ngô Văn Chiêu. He participated in different seances of spiritism, asking for the treatment of his elderly mother, who were very sick. And he received a prescription. The prescription worked. And later on, the situation getting worse, and he asked for more prescription. And the word from God said that there are no more prescription for him. And later on, he received the word from God, asking him, telling him to found noble religion, which is Kaudai, the new religion to guide the people of the world and to tell people of different religions that all religions are one, of the same divine origin, and the ethic of religions are based on love and justice, and the different religions are nothing else other than the different manifestation of the one same truth. And he asked for the representation of God, and God gave him the symbol of the divine eye. The eye is the principle of the heart. When you look a person to the eye, you understand that person. You feel the emotion of that person. And Yin energy and Yang energy are the master of the creation, master of everything. And science has proved that Yin energy and Yang energy are just electron and proton, and which are the basic constitution of everything in the universe. And the light, the energy, the spirit, and the spirit is God. And God is the divine spirit, and that is the master of every kind of spirit in the world, the everything in the world, in the universe. And at the same time, the group of people in Saigon well separated from Mr. Ngô Văn Chiêu, they received the same message through Spiritism. And together, the Supreme Being told those three people to meet with Mr. Ngô Văn Chiêu, and together they found Kaudaism. And I read for you the message from God. Formerly, people lacked transportation and therefore did not know each other. I then found it a different epoch in different area, the five branches of the great way, the way of humanity, the way of angel, the way of saint, the way of immortal, the way of Buddha, each based on the custom of the race. In present day, the transportation has been improved and people have come to know each other better, but they do not have harmony between people because of the very multiplicity of religion. And that's why I have decided to unite all those religions into one to return to their primordial unity. And we have a lot of challenge from people around because they heard about the word of God coming to people. And they wonder if those messages were true. And a group of people from Christian Elite came and challenged the seance. They put the picture of Jesus on the table. And they believe that if evil came to the seance, that they would not dare to come. And when the seance began, Saint Peter came and gave the following poem: "I've been keeping the gate of heaven in the west sky to spread the Tao to humanity. I've been serving humanity for almost 2,000 years. Now, God has entrusted me the mission to guide you all." And then God, the Supreme Being, came with the following message: "Do you know who was Jesus? I have shed my blood to humanity because of love. Now I have come to save humanity also because of love. Have you ever loved me that much? Repent in order to save yourself." And the Supreme Being had came down as Jesus to found Christianity. And this is another message from God saying, "Divankara Buddha is me. Sakyamuni Gautama Buddha is me. Lao Tse is me, who is Kanda." And God has manifested a different area, in different time, in different messenger to create a different religion to guide people. God also said, "Buddha, God Buddha are me, although different. All branches belong to the same trunk. Buddhism, Taoism, Christianity are in my hand. Because of love, I come to save humanity for the third time." And the Supreme Being is a great sacred light, great sacred energy, and human beings are the little sacred energies, little sacred light. And I am your master, and you are my children, and I am you, you are me. That means every one of us has God spirit inside ourselves. And if you keep ourselves more pure, cultivated, we will be united with the Supreme Being. And we can find God or the Buddha inside ourselves. And we can find the divine consciousness in ourselves. At that time, you even can receive the God's word in ourselves, the scripture, the divine scripture in ourselves. When the outer world becomes more tranquil, the true heart may be rich. One can then discern the true and the false. When one realizes that nothing is true or false, one has no more attachment, then one rejoins the Master at the Nirvana. And the word of God were received and collected in different, under different forms. We have a collection of selected holy messages. We have the Cao Dai Constitution, Cao Dai New Codes, Cao Dai Ritual and Prayer, and the true teaching of the Great Carrier. But they all just writing the book, just guiding you. But the most important message is you have to find yourself. You find the scripture in yourself. You don't need to have a teacher outside. The master is nothing, and the scripture is nothing, and the Tao is nothing. You just go back to yourself, and you find God in yourself, and united with the Supreme Being. And this is the origin of the Kabbalah scripture from the Supreme Being. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Booth, for sharing us the origin of the Kabbalah scriptures. Let's give him another round of applause for what he said. Helping us to understand even more about how it was composed, the collection of the different scriptures, the method, and even the concept of the Supreme Being or God or Creator, using messengers throughout history in different ways. It's very, very valuable to learn. And I want to continue to go down it and understand those kinds of things even more. So at this time, now that our amazing speakers have shared with us and we've seen the similarities and also the differences between the different faiths, we're going to open up this time so that people can ask questions to any of the ones here at the table. Not me though. But if you would like to ask them any questions regarding what they spoke on, or if you have any curiosities that came from just anything that you picked up today, let's open it up at this time and see who has what they would like to ask. Anyone? Oh, yes. Let's bring me the mic.
Test. Okay, it works.
I have a question about Hinduism. So, if there are no prophets, then how are the scriptures recorded?
As I mentioned before, the scriptures existed, the teachings were already existed even before, and it was through rishis, the seers, who were seeking that the sound, it was first the sound which was there, which was created, and that sound was interpreted and understood because they were seeking. So because of their seeking, the existential, the consciousness made it known to them, the messages. That is how they were able to listen to it and record it for future, for other generations. So for a very long time, it was only passed orally. But there was no written scriptures recorded, and it was much later recorded as scriptures.
I have a question for Mahavirupa. Can you elaborate on the role of meditation in our purification?
Yes, surely. It is meditation is a great tool to help us to connect with our own inner being. And the way it works is to bring us into a more awareness about whatever action we are doing. Normally we have a misnomer, we have a misconception that for meditating you have to be, you know, sitting under a tree with your eyes closed, you have to be of a particular age. That is all very incorrect. Any one of us can be, when you are in the present moment and very aware with all your senses of what you are doing, then you are in the state of meditation. So to be able to achieve that, because as of now, it is very difficult for us to reach that state right away. So we use various other methods, various other tools. So there are so many different kinds of meditations which help, you know, using sound, using chanting, mantra, whatever helps to divert our mind, because otherwise there's so many thoughts continuously taking place in our mind. So help to us to quieten those thoughts, to bring us down bring us, connect us more to our inner being. And that is what meditation helps us to do. So what you will, when you start a particular practice, when you're doing it repeatedly, you will find that you are automatically in falling into a space where you are more aware. And that is how, when you are more connected with your inner being, a lot more of your own potentialities become available to you. That is how meditation helps you. So you could be even meditating with your eyes open as long as you're aware and present for what you're doing.
So my question is for all the religious leaders. It seems there's a lot of different scriptures out there, and I was just wondering, everyone of course says that their own scriptures are valid, but I just wanted to ask what makes your scripture believable, and like what's the, like what evidence is there behind it that it can be believable? So that's my question for all of the articles.
So that's a very good question, and at least for what was also presented today, what makes the scriptures believable in a very simple sense is what has been stated many times, which is the prophecy and its fulfillment as well too. When something is stated multiple times or in different ways, and ultimately when it comes to pass and it comes to fulfill, you can know that that person who said those very words are truthful and, in a way, very honest. That's why, as they continue to speak more and more, you're one who is able to believe and have more faith in those words or in their future promise as well too. That's why within the Christian scriptures, within the Old Testament, there are over 300 different prophecies and promises regarding the coming of the Messiah, and about 600 to 700 years thereafter, there were accounts of witnesses, historical and biblical, that would record that there was someone who came in this way, and that is seen inside of the New Testament through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, specifically those four Gospels, but also expressed through Apostle Paul within the book of Acts and also the epistles as well too. All again describing the very work of what has fulfilled inside the Old Testament. So that's why, at least within the Christian perspective, this is what makes believing in the Bible much stronger belief.
Yeah, so in Hinduism, Sanatan Dharma, as I said, your way of living your life, righteous living, it is very much open to each one, each human being, you know, irrespective of their caste, color, creed, whatever. Religion is not imposed just because you are born into a particular family who is practicing a particular religion. It is never enforced on you. Religion is something for each one to discover for themselves. That is what is practiced in Hinduism. And also, it is experience-based. So, whatever it is that you are seeking, as you continue to seek and keep inquiring and ask, you actually get an experiential understanding where you do see some, you will get a feeling of extreme righteousness, something which will give you a surety, a validity to prove that yes, this is for me, this is correct. It resonates with me, and that is what leads you on. So irrespective of where you are, which part of the world you are, where you come from, religion is something which you discover. And of course, there is a lot of importance given to having a living master, a guru, who guides you along this path and who makes this process a very easy, a smooth ride for you. You don't have to be on a roller coaster. That's it. Thank you.
Yeah, very good question. And most scripture coming from the word of God. And if someone say, God told me to kill you, and God told me to take your money, is that the word of God? Let that be believable? Of course not. So the God's words are always good for everyone, for the whole human family of the whole world, not for some person's interest. So anything that coming from someone, some spirit, to yourself, to you, to your heart, telling you to serve people, to love people, and you can believe that the true word from God.
May I add to that? I'm not sitting up there, but I believe that the scripture is believable when you read it and you apply it and you feel peace in yourself and you can grow and unfold yourself and progress. So each one of us can experience that, and you can experience it with any one of the scripture. Whenever it is true word from God and you apply, You will feel love and joy, and you feel peace in yourself.
My question is for Dr. Louis. My question is, in the Islamic text, it denies the practice of spiritism, and it even refers to it as like witchcraft and sorcery. But I know the cow dye text, or they promote it. So my question is that if the God of Islam and is the same God as cow dye, why are they different? Why are the teachings different?
Yeah.
That is a very good question. I think, as my wife helped me, anything that we practice according to God's word, we feel happy inside. Yourself is very peaceful inside. In the other religion, maybe there are some differences in the practice, just the physical difference in the life. But in the truth, whatever inside yourself, if God is inside yourself, you will feel the same thing. So the difference is the outside difference. Like you and me, we wearing different clothes. We look at the life at different angle, and we can see life differently.
Really unites all religions, and even Hinduism encourages the search for truth. So my question is it permissible then to change your religion if you're searching for truth? And also, kind of like how Pastor David mentioned in the Christian doctrine or in the Bible, and specifically it says that if something is spoken by a prophet or by a person, but it doesn't come to pass or doesn't happen, then you can't really believe what that person said was from God. And so doesn't that seem kind of contradictory, especially like since in Kaldaism, both it's supposed to unite all religions, yet you know in Christianity it teaches that you have to go to Jesus and repent, but yet there's also this teaching of karma. So I'm sorry if my question's a little confusing, but I guess I'm trying to understand how does it all connect together without contradicting. I guess kind of like for Dr. Willie as well as for the Hinduism religion.
As I mentioned, we believe that we have the same unique God. Although God are called differently by different traditions. For example, my son called me Dad, my wife called me Honey. And my brother called me Brother. And my father called me Son. So although called differently, I'm still myself. So God, although He's called differently at different tradition, is unique. And we believe that different religions are just different manifestation of the same truth, different manifestation of same law. So if you practice Christianity, you are still the child of God. If you practice Hinduism, you're still the child of God. If you practice Muslim, you're still the child of Allah, the child of our own God Father. There would be no difference. So in Kaldai, we do not encourage people to try to convert different people to Kaldai, but we just want to give the message to all people that we are all children of God, and we are the same, and we have no difference. And you may keep your own religion. For example, if you are Christian and you have the spirit of Kaldai in yourself, you would not look at your friend, your Muslim friend or your Buddhist friend differently. You must look at them as your own brother and sister. And whatever religions you are practicing is always good if you have that spirit of fraternity, of the human family in yourself. And that would be good enough. And that would be the peaceful community in this world.
Yes, so to answer your question, in Hinduism also, religion is something, as I mentioned, religion is supposed to help you connect with your inner being. That is the main purpose of all religions, to help you to find your own inner self and to bring you to the understanding that there is really no difference between you and the divine being that has created everything. And so Hinduism is very open. Since we are all unique, all different, you know, having different likes and dislikes, if it is something that resonates with you, you stick with it. But the ultimate aim is to get to that point, to discover yourself, to discover that connection. That is the most important message. How you get there, what road you take is immaterial. It's open. And in Hinduism also, we do not believe in converting anybody, but we welcome anyone who is seeking and is wanting to learn, is welcome. Thank you.
I want to add one more thing. And as I say, I'm very comfortable to go into any mosque, any church, any temple, anywhere. Because in anywhere, I can find God in myself, and God is the same. It's not that I go to the mosque, I find God differently.
Thank you very much, everyone, for your very intelligent, thought-provoking, spirit-provoking questions, and thank you for answering so well. I know that we have grown with even more understanding, but I'm also sure that it's led to more questions too. So please keep coming back. So at this time, we're going to go and continue with the program by having our survey and question section of the event. And so the volunteers are going to pass out these papers to everyone that is here. And there's about 5 questions on there that are yes or no, as well as 7 of them that are survey question. So if we could just take a few minutes to read these over and to answer them, that would be wonderful. We use it for our research as an organization to continue our programs in the best ways, and also as something that we can talk about when we go into small groups as well. So let's take a little bit of time now to fill them out, and then we'll reconnect afterwards to continue with the event. Thank you. You missed one exit. Your whole day is thrown off. So we're going to, let's all rise together so that we can officially end this meeting of the Office of the Alliance of Religions on the topic of the origin of scriptures. And we will all together participate in the adjoining prayer of the Kaadai, which will be translated, and then also with the Lord's Prayer.
Nhờ lời chí tôn dạy con lẽ đạo Phật thánh tiên nhỏ máu nhiệt thành dạng linh đã hiện chí linh hội sống cậy sức công bình thiên linh đã gây dựng nên quyền giáo hóa phòng hiệp dày tròn cả nguyên nhân diễn toàn phạm thể thánh thân tuột theo chánh pháp độ lành chúng sinh cả con cúi đầu trình sư phụ nhìn từ tâm khuyến nhau u tăng đầu đạo hư vô sư hư vô reo chuông phó trọng phất cờ tuyệt sinh cưỡi đông dưới mái đình cơ tạo gương huệ đưa trị xảo trời tà cửa địa ngục chống đánh xa mượn hình thánh thể khi khắp nhà cõi thiên nam mô cao đại tiên âm đại bồ tát ma ha tát.
We entreat thee, guide us in this hour through your accordance divine. We assemble here around your teachings certifying the body has ascended, now the spiritual form transcended, the two have cycled round, the perfection to be found. Following the path of truth will help your students who abide. We vow and give our oath to let compassion be our guide, your sword of consecration by its gift of illumination. Your power justly given will guide our way of living. Your instructions you have given, the Tao is nil, the teacher nil,
our refuge in the nail, our heaven, our spiritual body is ours to build. We ring the living bell beyond our living hell to a higher form of life transcending earthly strife.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
That officially ends our time for the meeting of the Office of the Latitude of Religions. Look at your neighbor and say, we did it! Say, I'm so proud of you, and I love you very much, and let's eat. Thank you, everyone, and we'll see you in a couple of weeks. Please continue to spend time with each other and learn even more. Have a nice day.